John chapter 8. One of the favorite stories about Jesus' life is found in the first 12 verses. Actually, first 11 verses of this chapter. And what's ironic about it's a classic. I mean, it's such a classic story about Jesus, but it's not found in many of the older manuscripts, which has raised questions in scholars' minds as to whether it was part of John's gospel originally. There are some English Bibles that place it in brackets. They leave it where it is, but they place it in brackets with the footnote that this is not found in some of the oldest manuscripts. There are some that put it off as an appendix at the end of the Gospel of John. And some even place it elsewhere in order to communicate that they don't really believe that it was originally part of John's Gospel, at least not in this location. There are over 900 Greek manuscripts that contain it in this location. But the most ancient Greek manuscripts do not. Now, there's a lot of different kinds of manuscript evidence about this particular story, because some, as I said, about 900 manuscripts do include it here, but they're not the earliest, and therefore not the manuscripts that many scholars trust the most. And yet there's others that place it somewhere else. They place it in another location. In fact, there's even some manuscripts, one family of manuscripts, that place this story, these verses, at the end of Luke 21, which might seem strange. But actually, when you read this story, it's not strange. It actually sounds like a story from the Synoptic Gospels. For example, you find the expression, the scribes and Pharisees. The scribes, other than here, are not mentioned at all in John. And the term scribes and Pharisees is very common in the Synoptic Gospels. In Matthew and Mark and Luke, we read often of the scribes and Pharisees, but never in the Gospel of John. We do read of the Pharisees elsewhere in the Gospel of John, but never the scribes. And so the expression scribes and Pharisees is a typically synoptic kind of phrase, not very typically Johannine, or not typical John. Another thing is that this is a story that tells about the scribes and Pharisees coming to test Jesus with a difficult dilemma in order to find fault with him. This is something that the Synoptic Gospels describe as the tact of the scribes and Pharisees in the final week, the Passion Week of Jesus' life. In fact, if you look over at Luke chapter 21 just for a moment, Luke chapter 21 is the place where a few manuscripts actually place this story. And I'm not saying that it belongs here, but it certainly fits here very well. Because Luke 21, this is during the Passion Week. In verses 37 and 38, it says, "And in the daytime he was teaching in the temple, but at night he went out and stayed on the mount called Olivet. Then, early in the morning, all the people came to him in the temple to hear him." So, and it's at that point that some manuscripts actually place the story that we're about to read from John chapter 8. They place it after Luke 21:38. But you'll notice that these two verses at the end of Luke 21 describe Jesus' pattern of behavior during the Passion Week. He would stay at night on the Mount of Olives. And he would come in the morning and sit in the temple and teach, and people would come and listen to him. That's what we find actually going on. Notice John 8:1. "But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, but early in the morning he came again to the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them." It's very close to, almost verbatim, to what Luke 21 says in those verses we were looking at. And so some have thought that this really fits better into a context such as Luke 21, and that the manuscripts that preserve it there might be preserving it in its original location. But somehow, in the history of transmission of manuscripts, it somehow got transposed over into John's Gospel, where it was not originally a part. It doesn't really matter too much if we can figure out where the story originally stood. Almost all scholars are agreed it's an authentic story from the life of Jesus. In fact, it's possible that it was a story that survived independently of the four Gospels for some time. And then, because the early Christians knew it to be a true story, they sought to insert it in the places they wished to do so. And some put it here in this part of John, some put it in Luke, and so forth. That it might be a story that was not originally part of any of the four Gospels, but was just as authentic as the stories in the Gospels, and was preserved orally until it was inserted variously into different places in the Gospel tradition. In any case, I'm going to proceed on the assumption that it's a true story. It seems unlikely that one of the most amazing, beloved stories, one in which Jesus' genius and poise and composure are illustrated probably as much as in any place in the Gospels, maybe the greatest example. That would somehow be something that somebody made up. Now, there are stories that people made up about Jesus. We know that because we have in the 2nd and 3rd century, Gnostic Gospels that have legends about Jesus. But they're kind of magical, weird, not true-to-life kind of stories about Jesus. You know, he does miracles, but they're ridiculous miracles. Not miracles like healing people or doing things that really are helpful, but more like making birds out of clay when he's a child and they turn into real birds and fly away, or striking his playmates dead by cursing them and they supernaturally die. These are some of the stories that come in the Gnostic Gospels, the kind of stuff of legends that doesn't fit the story of Jesus at all, where this hardly has the character of a legend. It fits like a glove into the narrative of the story of Jesus. It's a case where Jesus places his opponents on the horns of a dilemma. Actually, they place him on the horns of a dilemma, but he turns it back on them. This is quite typical of the kind of thing that was going on in the Passion Week. Now, we're not at this point in John looking at the Passion Week yet. We have yet to go to later on in chapter 9 and 10, but we're going to be looking at the Feast of Dedication, which is Hanukkah, and that's in December, and it wasn't until the next April that Jesus was crucified. Regardless what the correct setting of this story is, this is where we encounter it in our present manuscripts of John. And so we'll just treat it without concern about its context or its chronology and just see what it tells us about Jesus. Actually, the disputed portion begins in the last verse of chapter 7, verse 53, that says, "And everyone went to his own house." That's actually part of the block of material that's missing, along with the first 11 verses of chapter 8 in many manuscripts. So this "everyone went to his own house" in its present location speaks of the conclusion of a dialogue between the chief priests, Pharisees, soldiers, and Nicodemus about the failure of the soldiers to arrest Jesus, and then being scolded by the chief priests who had sent them to do that errand, and saying, are you deceived also? Have any of the rulers of the Jews believed in him? These common people are cursed. They don't even know the law. But in answer to the question, have any of the rulers of the Jews believed in him, Nicodemus speaks up sheepishly and says, I'm not so sure we should condemn this man without hearing his case. And we know, of course, from other material in John that Nicodemus was, in fact, a believer in Jesus. He didn't quite say so, but he did speak up objecting to the unfairness of their condemning Jesus without really giving a thorough examination to the merits of his teaching and what he's doing. Anyway, that ended up with the Pharisees and scholars scolding Nicodemus, one of their own, and saying, "Search and look." He said, "Are you also a Galilean? Search and look. No prophet arises out of Galilee." And that's where we left off last time. And so if chapter 7, verse 53 properly belongs in this location, we find that everyone going to their own house was simply a conclusion to this unsatisfactory disagreement that they had. They didn't come to any agreement among themselves, and so they just parted and went different ways. Meanwhile, we see Jesus going himself to the Mount of Olives. Now, I believe it's possible that he camped out on the Mount of Olives from time to time, but he did have friends who lived over there in Bethany, which is just a couple miles there from Jerusalem. And Jesus did sometimes go to Bethany for the night, especially in the final week, he was staying with his friends Mary and Martha and Lazarus, who lived in Bethany. But here it doesn't mention Bethany, and he may have just camped out under the stars on the Mount of Olives at night with his disciples, we assume. We do not read that they are with him at this time, but they usually were. Early in the morning, he came again to the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. Then the scribes and the Pharisees brought him a certain woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what do you say?" Now this they said, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with his finger, as though he did not hear. So when they continued asking him, he raised himself up and said to them, "He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first." And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. Then those who heard it, being convicted of their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning with the oldest even to the last, and Jesus was left alone and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, "Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said to her, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." All right, this is a great story, obviously. And it raises questions about a number of things. One of them is, what did Jesus write on the ground? We read twice of him stooping down and writing on the ground. The first time it's mentioned, verse 6, in the New King James, it says, "He did so as though he did not hear." That line is missing from the Alexandrian text, and therefore its original presence in the passage is disputed. If it was not there, we have less to go on than if it is there, because if in fact he did it as though he did not hear, it means he was not writing anything relevant to the story. He's just ignoring them. He was just doodling. He was not writing anything of significance that we need to figure out what it was, the mystery. What did Jesus write in the dust on the floor? If in fact the passage originally said that he wrote as if he didn't hear, then the point is he's ignoring them completely, not writing anything relevant to what they've asked, or else he wouldn't be doing it as if he didn't hear. But it is not in all the manuscripts. And therefore, many people believe that what Jesus wrote was something relevant to this. And we'll have to discuss what that could have been, since that is a possibility. We also need to perhaps wonder how it was that this situation got set up as it was. This was in the daytime, we're told. This woman is caught in adultery, apparently in the daytime, in the very act. Now, if someone is caught in the very act, there must be two people there. It's not that she was caught afterward and confessed or something, and the man who was involved with her was unidentified. She was caught in the act, if the accusation is true. And if that's true, there was a man involved. Now, the law did, in fact, say that an adulterous woman should be stoned, but it also said that both partners should be stoned to death. Under the law, adultery was a capital crime, and both participants were criminals, and they both suffered the same fate. The Pharisees knew this. Jesus knew this. Everybody knew this. So it seems strange that they didn't give any explanation of how they caught a man and a woman committing a criminal act and brought only the woman and let the man get away. Now, of course, one possibility is that the man was more agile and stronger, and he broke loose and he was able to run faster, and he escaped, and so they just let him go, and they grabbed her. That's possible. There's also another possibility, I think, and this is my speculation. You don't need to put any weight on it at all. I wouldn't be surprised if the one that was with her was one of them. That is to say, not one of them in the crowd, but somebody that was one of their friends. In fact, I wouldn't even be surprised if they'd set the whole thing up. Because it says they wanted to test him. Now, if you want to bring a test case like this, though, and you got to catch somebody committing adultery, that's not the easiest thing to do, just at whenever you want to. Well, let's just go find someone committing adultery and bring them to Jesus. Really? Well, most people who commit adultery are rather secretive about it. It's not as if you can just, anytime you want to, locate someone in the act of adultery. That's the kind of thing that usually is done cloaked in darkness. Usually it's done, when nobody's likely to find out. How these religious leaders would stumble into a room and find a couple committing adultery is hard to know, unless they knew. Unless they maybe even had prior knowledge of it. And perhaps they even set it up with maybe one of their guys was the guy that was involved. I don't know for sure. But it was certainly, if they wished to do this kind of thing, to bring a test like this to Jesus, it was certainly fortunate of them to stumble upon this particular act being committed, and to make no attempt, apparently, to condemn the man involved. And more than that, when Jesus said, "He that is without sin among you, let him be the first to cast a stone at her," many scholars believe that without sin does not mean, perfectly sinless. Because after all, it's not necessary for a judge or an executioner to be perfectly sinless in order to carry out his duties. Most scholars believe that when he said, "Let him that is without sin be the first to cast a stone," he means whoever is not involved in this sin, whoever is not complicit in this, would be another way of saying it. Now, there's different ways to see it. Some scholars think he's saying whoever has never done a sin like this before shouldn't condemn her for doing it. But many have felt that the weight of his statement was whoever has not committed this sin, whoever is not involved in this sin, whoever is not an accomplice in this, let him be the first to cast a stone at it. If his words carry that meaning, then of course it suggests very strongly that Jesus knew that they had been involved. This was a conspiracy. This was something they had set up. They were all involved in this. They had brought it about. Now, it's not necessary to see it that way. That's why I say this is my own speculation. I've never heard anyone suggest that theory. But it seems to me that there are elements of the story that would lend themselves to that construction. That would explain how they were fortunate enough to find the act in progress, how it was that they cared very little about the man's being punished, and perhaps how they would have understood Jesus' statement, whoever's not guilty of this sin, let him be the first to stone her. Now, by the way, there is another way that could be understood, even if Jesus' words do mean whoever has not committed this sin, because he could mean that his accusers actually had committed adultery on other occasions. Now, we might think he's referring to his teaching on the Sermon on the Mount about whoever looks at a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her in his heart, but we wouldn't expect the Pharisees to be convicted on that basis, since they were probably not listening to the Sermon on the Mount, which was delivered to Jesus' disciples, nor would they necessarily have agreed with him on that. It's clear that whatever he said made them feel convicted. They knew that they were busted. And so, from the oldest on down to the last, they all kind of faded off into the crowd. So, it must be, or at least it seems like it must be, that they understood him to be saying, whoever has not committed a capital crime like this, maybe this very same sin, let him be the first to cast a stone at her. Because it would not be possible to go into a courtroom and say, "The judge, you might as well go home because you're not a sinless man. You can't condemn these thieves and these robbers and these gang members and these murderers because you're not a sinless man. You have to be without sin to do that." Jesus never would have said that. Jesus did not come to overthrow the government or overthrow the legal system or the criminal justice system. What would be the result of that? Criminals would be running loose unchecked and victimizing people all the time. This is not what Jesus came to do. When Jesus talked about not resisting the evil man and turning the other cheek, he's telling his disciples how to respond to people who are hostile to them. He's not telling magistrates how to adjudicate when criminals are brought to them. It's not saying just let them walk. They're evil men. You courtrooms, you shouldn't be resisting evil. Well, that's what the courtrooms are there for. The Bible says that in the New Testament. God has ordained governments to punish evildoers. Jesus didn't change that. And therefore, this was actually a criminal case. This was a capital crime under the law that a person who committed adultery should be put to death. just like a murderer or many other kinds of criminals should be. And Jesus would not be saying, yeah, but there should never be any, you know, criminal penalties unless the person who's the executioner is sinless. That's not what he means when he says he lives without sin. It's more whoever is not guilty of either this sin or at least one of equal weight, whoever is not more as guilty as she is, whoever doesn't have on his conscience a sin of the same magnitude as hers, and maybe he might even be implying this very sin and this very instance. I don't know. I just put those things out there as possibilities that would help to explain some of the things that are otherwise difficult to make sense of. Now, the point here is, they brought this woman to Jesus as a test of him. They wished to test him, it says. How was this a test of him? I said that they put him in a position to have to be on the horns of a dilemma, as we say. A situation where you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. No matter what you say, you're in trouble. Because they give you a yes or no choice. And neither choice is okay. It's like what Jesus himself did to the scribes and Pharisees. When he said to them, they came to him and they said, well, by what authority do you do these things? And he said, well, let me ask you a question. John's baptism, was that, by what authority did John baptize? Was that of God or of man? Now, he only gave him two choices. There wasn't a third option. But both of them were unacceptable options to them. Because if they said, well, John's baptism was from God, they knew Jesus would then say, well, then why did you oppose him if he's from God? If he's a prophet from God, why didn't you accept him? So they didn't want to say that. Of course, what they really wanted to say was his baptism was of man. But they knew, and they reasoned among themselves as they deliberated about how they should answer Jesus. They said, if we say it's from man, we fear the people because they think John's a prophet. Now, we don't like John, but we don't want the people to know we don't think he's a prophet because that would really make us look dull spiritually. And so they came to Jesus and said, well, we can't answer you that. And Jesus said, well, then I can't answer your question either. You're not going to be honest with me. I'm not going to be honest with you. I won't tell you. But he had them on the horns of a dilemma. That's what the expression means. He did that again to them on another occasion when he was in the synagogue early in his ministry and the man with the withered hand was there. And, of course, his enemies were there to see if he was going to heal on the Sabbath so they could find something to accuse him of. And he knew it. He saw them there and he called the man forward. He told the man to step forward. And, of course, his enemies were on the edge of their seats waiting to see if he's going to do something they can charge him with, something actionable, some kind of healing on the Sabbath, because this was not a case of a life-threatening situation. Under the law, or at least under the rabbinic understanding of the law, a physician could heal somebody on the Sabbath if the guy was dying and going to die before the next day. But if he had no life-threatening situation, he had to wait. Couldn't do that on the Sabbath. Had to do it the next day or some other day. In fact, there was a time when Jesus healed a woman in the synagogue on the Sabbath who was bent over and couldn't stand up for 18 years. And the synagogue official, angry at Jesus, rebuked the crowd, saying, there are 6 days when you can bring your sick to be healed. Come on 6 days, but don't do it on the Sabbath. And Jesus turned to the man and started rebuking him in front of the congregation. Jesus, it would have been interesting to be at some of those services. You know, I mean, can you imagine having a guest speaker at church and the pastor stands up and starts rebuking him and the guest speaker starts rebuking the pastor right there on the platform in front of the whole audience? That'd be a tense situation. Jesus did that in the synagogues. But the man with the withered hand, Jesus knew they wanted to accuse him if he healed, and he knew he was going to heal him. He was going to do it whether they liked it or not. But he said first of all to him, what's lawful to do on the Sabbath? To do good or to do evil? Well, he didn't give them a third option. It's either one or the other, right? It's lawful to do good or it's lawful to do evil. Which do you say? And the Bible says they remained silent. They wouldn't answer. Why? They didn't like either answer. If they said it's lawful to do evil, that would make no sense. It's not lawful to do evil on the Sabbath. But if they said it's lawful to do good on the Sabbath, well, they just gave him permission then to heal this man. That's clearly a good thing. And then they couldn't accuse him of anything if they just gave him permission. So they didn't want to say anything. And that's the only time we read that Jesus looked on them with anger, being grieved at the hardness of their hearts. He was so angry because they weren't honest. You know, sometimes a dilemma is a rhetorical device to win a debate. Legitimately, because the opponent's position is so wrong that you can point out to be wrong by saying, okay, from your point of view, is this the correct option or is this the correct option? And it's obvious that those are the only two possibilities. And from the standpoint of the person you're debating, because they don't have the truth on their side, both prongs, both horns of the dilemma are unacceptable. That's what they've done to Jesus. They thought. They came to him and said, Moses said this woman should be put to death. What do you say? Now, why is that a dilemma? Jesus could easily say, well, of course, I agree with Moses on this. She should be put to death. But they suspected he wouldn't. After all, he did have a lot of friends who were sinners. Some of them were notorious sinners. Some of them were notorious sexual sinners. There were prostitutes and tax collectors and other kinds of sinners among the people that Jesus obviously was friendly toward. And if he had said, yes, go ahead and stone her, that would have indeed shocked his supporters, who were largely made up of people who were had those kinds of compromises in their lives already. It would seem so uncharacteristic of him, and for him to take that hard line would put him into trouble with his followers. Although he could have done it anyway. I mean, he never really chose his comments in order to be popular with his followers. In fact, sometimes he chose the comments in order to drive followers away. If he could, if they could go, he wanted them going. If they were not among those who could say, Lord, to whom shall we go? You alone have the words of eternal life. If that wasn't where they stood, he wanted them to go. And he would even use offensive language deliberately, as he did in John chapter 6, to make people go away who weren't going away quickly enough. They were following him and insisting on following him, but for the wrong reasons, so he didn't want them there. Now, therefore, of course, Jesus would never have been intimidated by the suggestion that he should say something unpopular. But they knew that Jesus was in some ways slack, as they thought, about the law of Moses. After all, they considered him to be a repeated offender on the Sabbath question. Sabbath breaking was also a capital offense on Jewish law. And yet he was very slack about Sabbath keeping, they thought. They thought he had come to destroy the law. That's why Jesus had to say to his disciples, don't think I've come to destroy the law. Or the prophets, I didn't come to destroy, I came to fulfill them. Why would he have to say that? Why would anyone even raise the issue of him coming to destroy the law? Because that's what people thought. He was, the way he was acting, he was violating the traditional understanding of the rabbis, and therefore, to their mind, violating the law. And he did, in fact, violate the Sabbath. But he said he had the authority to do that because he was the Son of God, and God violates the Sabbath, and what his Father does, the Son can do. The point is, though, the opponents of Christ were angry at him for this very reason. They felt like he played fast and loose with the law. Therefore, if he said, well, the law said we should stone her, and they felt that that was pretty much against Christ's disposition in general, and his friendship with all these sinners, pretty sure they thought he wasn't going to take a hard line in favor of the law at this point. And if he didn't, then they could accuse him of opposing Moses. Even though the Mosaic law would be an unpopular one in this case, Jesus' friends, of course, they wouldn't much be excited about the idea of following Moses' laws on this case and stoning this woman. But nonetheless, if Jesus didn't stand by the law, then he could easily be accused of being anti-Moses, which wouldn't go down well with any of the Jews. He could easily be accused of being subversive and against Judaism, because Judaism was defined by the law of Moses. So there wasn't really an answer that Jesus could give that wouldn't get him into some kind of trouble. And it's not just that. You see, if he said, don't stone her, as I said, then he could be accused of breaking the law. The Jews turn against him. But if he said, do stone her, if he simply upheld what Moses said, he'd be not only in trouble with his public, but he'd be in trouble with the Romans. Because the Romans, when they had conquered that region, though they had left the Sanhedrin a measure of freedom to adjudicate crimes and punishments, Rome had deprived the Jews of the right to exercise capital punishment. And although they sometimes did it as mob action, stoning people and so forth, like Stephen or others occasionally, We don't know that they were going to stone this woman. This was more to test Jesus than to get this woman stoned. They brought her to him. But there were times when the Jews went ahead and stoned people and then dispersed too quickly before the Romans could pin on anyone. But the Romans did not allow them to coolly dictate capital punishment and carry it out. And that's what these Jews were asking Jesus to decide. Should we kill her? If he said yes, then they could go to Pilate, the Roman governor, and say, this guy's telling people to violate the Roman law. The Roman law tells us we can't kill people, and he's telling people to do that. So either Jesus is going to be represented as violating the Jewish law or the Roman law. And he'll be in trouble either with the Jews or the Romans. Neither is very desirable. This was the dilemma that they had in mind. Now, Jesus initially didn't answer them. He instead stooped down. They were in the temple, and he wrote on the temple floor, in the dust of the temple floor. And then he did it again later. He stood up and answered them. They stooped down and did it again. Now, if, of course, that line is authentic and original that says, as if he never heard them, then it's almost like he wasn't even giving them the time of day. And he looked up and said, oh, you're still here? I'll give you an answer. Then he ignores them again. You know, he's just like, he's not going to, dignify them with attention and with a response. That is one possibility. But, of course, preachers and Bible students have often speculate about specific things Jesus might have been writing. There are actually a few manuscripts that are not very authoritative that actually include some lines about how he wrote down the sins of everyone in the crowd. And there are preachers who have suggested that's what he did, that Jesus knew the hearts of every man. He knew what those people had done, so he began to list in writing all the sins that they had committed. And then he said, now anyone who hasn't committed a sin, I'd be the first to cast a stone. You see, his comments would be related to what he'd written. But then he stooped down and wrote some more. Now, I don't know if he was continuing, an appendix to the list or what in that case. I'm not sure that this is a likely scenario. I've never really been very convinced. And there's no reason necessarily to be convinced. It's just someone's theory. It's just a guess. There are others who feel that what Jesus wrote down was the law. They start writing down the Ten Commandments. Now, remember, Paul said, without the law, I would not have known sin. I felt just fine about my covetousness until I read the law that says, thou shalt not covet. And he says, by the law is the knowledge of sin. If he wanted to convict these people of sin, he could just start putting laws down and letting them read them and then say, now, anyone not committed sin? Here's the law. And so some have felt that that's what he was doing, writing down the law. That's another possibility. No, it's only a guess. No one can say for sure if it's true. I've always seen some similarity in this story, but not close enough to make a tight connection to the law of, in the Old Testament, in Numbers, the law that is sometimes called the ordeal of jealousy. It's an interesting and strange law, but it has to do with the dust on the tabernacle floor, and it has to do with adultery. And therefore, it just seems to be interesting that this case of the woman taken in adultery involves also Jesus and the dust on the temple